Welcome to our discussion of adrenal gland pathology. Before we begin, we'll take a look at the adrenal cortex and do a brief review. The illustration here on your right, you divide your axis into two components like you would with many of the other axes. For example, the hypothalamus and the pituitary play a role in many axes, including that of your gonads, hypothalamus, pituitary, gonadal axis that we'll talk about later, hypothalamus, pituitary, type of thyroid axis that we have discussed. Here we have the hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal axis. From the hypothalamus, the pattern that we've established over and over again is that you release your releasing hormones. This then triggers the pituitary to then release the appropriate hormone, where in this case, it would be ACTH. And the target organ for ACTH would in fact be your adrenal cortex. Let's dive into this a little bit deeper. From your hypothalamus, we have the corticotropin-releasing hormone, which then acts upon your antipituitary here. And when it does so, it triggers the breakdown of your pro-opio. The opioid would be beta-endorphin. The melano would be the melanocyte-stimulating hormone. And the corticotrope would obviously be our ACTH, our primary focus of our entire discussion. ACTH will then be released into circulation, and then the receptor that you see down at the bottom would represent the receptor upon the adrenal cortex. You are now down in your abdominal region. In the box, what you're seeing here is the control of ACTH and when ACTH would play a role, especially its responsibility would be cortisol release. Sure, ACTH has a minor influence upon aldosterone synthesis. And I say minor because for you to form a fully fledged or fully mature aldosterone, that's a discussion that we'll have in a little bit. But ACTH is definitely responsible for cortisol synthesis. And cortisol is incredibly important during those times of stress. What kind of stress? Well, how about fasting when you're hungry? Infection. And any time that you're fasting, you know that you then have to follow your gluconeogenic pathway. So cortisol and glucagon will always have permissive action. If at any point in time you're missing cortisol, your patient now is at risk for death. So absolutely necessary for sustenance of life. When is cortisol released? At the end of the day, when you feel tired, is when your cortisol levels are the lowest. Around midnight and thereafter, when you're sleeping, at night is when your cortisol levels start rising. Wake up in the morning, it is at its highest level. We call this, number one, diurnal rhythm. It is imperative that you know the normal rhythm of your cortisol because you will be responsible for understanding how the dexamethasone suppression test actually functions. You will be responsible for that. I'll walk you through it. It is a stress hormone and cortisol inhibition. If you take a look at the picture on your left, you'll notice that cortisol has inhibitory effect or feedback upon your hypothalamus and the antipituitary, inhibiting the release of those respective hormones. ACTH, do not forget, will work through your GS protein. Therefore, we'll have cyclic AMP as its signal transducer. Here, the adrenal cortex down in the abdomen, what I'd like for you to do is establish a pattern of what this looks like anatomically. Granted, these are biochemical pathways, but from left to right, you'll be moving from superficial to deep. So I literally need you to think of the adrenal gland. And our focus only in this discussion will be with the cortex, right? Whereas the medulla will be responsible for epinephrine, a discussion to be had at a later time. Now with the cortex, you'll be moving from superficial to deep. I need you to move from the left in the left column. And at this point, all we're doing is an overview. We will get into greater detail where you will be able to see these specific substrates and enzymes, but I just want you to understand the pattern here. We have the zona glomerulosa. We'll then refer to what's known as a zona fasciculata, responsible for cortisol release. And then finally, reticularis, which is that green box that you see way to the right. And that is the reticularis. That is the deepest structure of the adrenal cortex. So those are the three columns that we will be focusing upon. Each one of those columns play a pivotal role with synthesis of various adrenal cortical hormones. Adrenal cortex in the cell. Where are we? Okay, now, the same pattern, but now we're blowing it up. First, you'll notice ACTH binding to the receptor. We have GS protein, cyclic AMP. It is important that you know the enzyme here. Understand that cholesterol is brought into the adrenal cortex. Cholesterol from biochemistry, carried by LDL, and I will give you a little bit of an overview to show you the LDL receptors bringing in the cholesterol. That is important for you to know. Because at any point in time, if LDL receptors aren't working properly, such as type 2 hyperlipidemia, you can't even bring in cholesterol into your organ. Anyhow, cholesterol is the omnipotent factor here that is responsible for synthesis of adrenal cortical hormones. So begin there, please. Next, the rate-limiting enzyme that we'll refer to here is called desmolase, responsible for breaking down your cholesterol into pregnenolone. Now, where are you in the adrenal cortex? This first column, and all we're doing is the first step here, is the zona glomerulosa. You tell me what the zona glomerulosa is responsible for synthesizing. Good, aldosterone. However, as I said, ACTH will kick start the synthesis of aldosterone. But it will not complete the job. That's important because you know that aldosterone and its major feedback is going to be with whom? You've heard of the acronym RAS, right? Renin, angiotensin, aldosterone. So renin, clinically, will be the most important feedback for you with aldosterone. Let's move on. We're then going to move from the glomerulosa into the fasciculata, which is that blue box that you see there. Here, there's an enzyme that will take you from the glomerulosa to the fasciculata. This is then noted and abbreviated as 17-alpha-hydroxylase. So 17-alpha-hydroxylase is an enzyme that allows you to go from your glomerulosa into the fasciculata. That must be understood. At some point in time, obviously, we'll start talking about pathologies in which you're deficient or your patient is deficient of certain enzymes. 17-alpha-hydroxylase deficiency could be a possibility, but I'll tell you which ones to focus upon first. Something else that I want you to focus on. Now that we're officially in our fasciculata, you have something called hydroxy. You see that? So this is hydroxypregnenolone. That becomes important for us, and it's 17-hydroxypregnenolone. That becomes important for us because of, just keep that in mind, they could ask you something about what you might find in the urine, and I'll give you a table in which we will take a look at that further. And then you go from your fasciculata down into the green box there. That would be the deepest of the layers, and that would be your reticularis, and that DHEA stands for dihydroxyepiandrosterone. Your focus there would be the A, because the reticularis is responsible for synthesizing androgen type of hormones. Androgen, not estrogen. So anytime that you would find, let's say, excess activity of the reticularis, what's your patient going to look like? If it's a female, a young girl, masculinization, right? If it's a male, well, he's already a boy, but he might then have or experience precocious puberty. Let's move on. We're going to add bit by bit by bit so that you remain focused and organized with what is happening. Our next enzyme here, I'll tell you exactly what to take a look at here, would be where we left off in the glomerulosa. Identify that first, and that'll be your leftmost column. We already discussed desmolase and pregnenolone. And in the previous discussion, we went from pregnenolone into the fasciculata with the name of that enzyme called 17-alpha-hydroxylase. That's what that bar stands for. That bar that you see there is an enzyme. But what if you want to go through each of the columns? What if you want to go from, please identify pregnenolone. Next, I want you to then identify your progesterone. How did you convert your pregnenolone to progesterone? Very important that you know this enzyme. It's called 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. It's abbreviated here as being 3-beta, at least be able to identify 3-beta. 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase. Where is this enzyme located? You see that bar horizontally? It is in the superficial most layer, the glomerulosa. It is also in the fasciculata. It is also in the reticularis. Hence, you see the bar going all the way through the cortex. What does it help you do? It helps you go through each layer. Meaning to say, you'll go within the glomerulosa, you convert your pregnenolone into progesterone. Next, I want you to go into blue box. That's your fasciculata. We were at hydroxypregnenolone. Identify that. With the help of the enzyme 3-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase, you convert it into 17-hydroxyprogesterone. And then finally, reticularis, I told you to focus upon the letter A, because that then to you means an androgen. The androgen here will be androstenedione. Our next enzyme that we'll take a look at, and ultimately the most important enzyme of all the enzymes so far, we looked at 2, 17-alpha, 3-beta. However, the most important enzyme, and the reason I say that is because there's a pathology that you know of known as congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Who's your patient? Congenital. Child. So, in utero, the child, the fetus, never developed the enzyme. There are three enzymes that might be deficient. Of all the enzymes, actually four to be technical, but at least know the most important one. Of all the enzymes that could be deficient in the adrenal cortex, it is this one, this one, this one. Which one is it? Am I referring to? 21-beta-hydroxylase. Here, abbreviated as 21-beta. What does it do? Take a look. That 21-beta-hydroxylase, first and foremost, where do you see the bar? The bar is horizontal, only located in the glomerulosa, only located in fasciculata, obviously not located in the reticularis. So you don't need it there. Hence, the bar stops there. What does it do? Ah, now this is where it becomes important and really interesting, because I'm going to add in your clinical application. I'm going to show your patient, or you're going to imagine your patient here. So you take the, I want you to go with the glomerulosa. We're at the progesterone. From your progesterone, what did this enzyme help you convert to? 21-beta-hydroxylase permitted you to convert into your DOC, D-O-C. That stands for 11-deoxycorticosterone, or 11-DOC. That you have to commit to memory. It has weak, physiologically, it has weak mineralocorticoid activity. Weak mineralocorticoid activity, physiologically. Pathologically, completely different picture. What does mineralocorticoid activity mean to you? It means it's reabsorbing sodium and water. The operative element, the sodium. You tell me, if you're reabsorbing, retaining more sodium, what does it affect? Blood pressure? Sure. And blood pressure meaning what? Systolic, diastolic, right? Blood pressure will be elevated when you're retaining more sodium. Let's talk about this patient, and our focus and your focus should be on 21-beta-hydroxylase. Keep in mind that they could technically give you other enzyme deficiencies. But let me show you. If you're deficient in 21-beta-hydroxylase, identify it please. Are you producing any DOC? No. If you're not producing any DOC, you sure as heck are not producing any aldosterone. If you have no mineralocorticoid, what's your blood pressure in your child? Decreased. Okay, we'll talk more about this later, step by step by step, so that you have a firm understanding of these enzymes and how they operate. There's another enzyme here. We're now moving on to the blue bar, which is 11-beta-hydroxylase. What does it do? Notice here, please. Now at this point, we can move a little bit faster. I believe that you've established a pattern quite well. So in the glomerulosa, which is the first column on your left, which is responsible for aldosterone synthesis, you'll notice that this bar representing the enzyme is only in the glomerulosa and it's only in the fasciculata. Once again, why do you require it in the reticularis? You already have your androgen, so let it go. Next, where do we leave off in the glomerulosa? We formed our duct, ductocorticosterone. Please be very careful because you will get answer choices in biochemistry, in which your deoxycorticosterone might look like your deoxycortisol. You see that in the blue box. They look alike, and you're tired, maybe, perhaps, when you're taking the exam. Very easy that your eyes could get confused between those two. Do not ever do that. So we'll take our doc, and with the help of the enzyme 11-beta-hydroxylase, we'll then form our corticosterone. And that corticosterone, with the help of, here's an enzyme called aldosterone synthase. Aldosterone synthase? What's responsible for stimulating aldosterone synthase? Well, if you know it's aldosterone, what is its major feedback mechanism? Renin, angiotensin. What kind of angiotensin? Angiotensin 2 stimulates aldosterone synthase so that you form your aldosterone. Welcome to RAS. We've completed discussion of the glomerulosa. Let's move over into the blue box, which is the fasciculata. You'll notice here that your deoxycortisol is being converted into cortisol. And this little stanza there says that cortisol, remember, these are all adrenal cortical hormones. These are all lipid soluble. They'll pass through the membrane. And where is the receptor for your adrenal cortical hormones located? Nucleus or cytoplasm? Good. Cytoplasm. And that's what that paragraph says there. In the meantime, take a look at the reticularis. What are you producing? What kind of hormones? General theme, androgen, androgen, androgen. This is an overview of adrenal cortex and its major enzymes. Your focus should be on 20-beta-hydroxylase. And I gave you one little clue here about your patient, where if your patient is deficient of the enzyme 21-beta, you're not producing any mineralocorticoid, your patient's blood pressure is decreased. I will tell you later as to why your patient will be, if your patient is a female, the young girl will be virilized, or if it's a male, then your child, the boy, will be experiencing precocious puberty. I'll tell you why. For those of you that are ahead of me, you already understand this.